Scholastic Audio presents The 39 Clues, Cahill Files, Operation Trinity, by Clifford Riley, read by David Pittu. On the letterhead of McIntyre, MacArthur, Mulligan, and Smoot, attorneys at law. To whom it may concern, the information in this book comes from the Cahill Vault, which means that none of it was meant for your eyes. Over the past 500 years, a number of exceedingly dangerous items have been placed in the vault for safekeeping. Assassination orders, confession-filled diaries, treasure maps, and many other items that I know better than to list here. Documents that have sparked wars, incited revolutions, and led to the downfall of governments, kings, and empires. It was not my idea to make this material public. I was given specific instructions by my former employer, William McIntyre, to protect the information in the vault. However, after recent tragic events, it looks like I'm taking orders from someone new, someone who believes that the Cahill files are essential to the security of the Cahill family and the world at large. And so, the vault has been opened. Do with these stories what you will. But when you find yourself weighed down by the secrets and scandals that shaped history, just remember one thing. I told you so. Clifford Riley. Part 1. Ghent, 1566. Matthias Jacobs scraped his spoon along the side of the wooden bowl, filling it with flakes of dried stew. Once he finished his supper, his visit home would be over, and he'd have to start his long ride back to the cathedral. He turned to the window. The sun was already beginning to set, flooding the wheat field with soft orange light. His father and his oldest brother, Adrian, were out there somewhere, trying to coax the plants from the barren ground. Since Adrian would inherit the family land, the younger boys had to learn a trade. Lucas was already apprenticed to the local blacksmith, and Matthias had assumed that he'd also be sent to work when he turned 13 next year. But instead of finding him a job with the village baker or carpenter, his mother had arranged for him to serve as an altar boy at St. Bavo Cathedral in Ghent. A morning's ride on a proper horse, a half day on their pokey mule, Mungo.
"Are you almost ready, Birte?"
His mother, Anna, called from the back of the room, where she was tucking baby Grecia into her cradle. Matthias scrunched his face, although he secretly liked it when his mother called him Little Bear, a reference to the dark, curly hair that distinguished him from his blonde brothers.
"You need to hurry if you want to get to the city before dark," Anna said.
Matthias looked down to keep his mother from seeing the blush spreading across his cheeks. His hair wasn't all that set him apart. He was the only one of his brothers who was afraid of the dark, who was afraid of anything, really. That was probably why he'd been sent to the cathedral instead of being apprenticed. He was an embarrassment. Matthias's father, Joost, had no patience for his spindly, clumsy son, who could barely haul a full bucket of water without drenching his tunic. He'd seen the shame in his father's face when Matthias limped home after losing a fight. Before Matthias could reply, there was a knock at the front entrance. That was odd. The family and their neighbors always came through the kitchen.
"Go see who it is, Bertje,"
Anna called. Matthias lifted the latch and pulled open the heavy door, revealing a tall, slender man in a strange outfit. Instead of a tunic and trousers, he wore a brocade jacket over knee breeches and white silk stockings. At first, Matthias wondered how the man had managed to stay so clean, but then he heard the stomp of a hoof. An elegant carriage, pulled by four matching dappled grays, had stopped in the middle of the road.
"Is this the Jacobs home?"
the man asked. He had a strange accent, and he grimaced slightly as he spoke, as if the foreign words left a sour taste in his mouth. Matthias nodded. The man removed a letter from the pouch, hanging at his hip.
"Are you quite sure?"
He raised an eyebrow.
It's treason to tamper with a message from the king.
The king? Then perhaps the messenger was looking for another Jakob's family. Surely King Philip wouldn't have business with his parents.
Who is it?
Anna's voice called from behind him. Matthias stepped aside to let his mother pass.
Can I help you?
She asked, wiping her hands on her apron.
I have a letter for Mefrau Jakobs,
the messenger said with a note of irritation in his voice.
I am Mefrau Jakobs.
Mefrau Anna Jakobs?
He asked, giving her an appraising look.
I have come a long way, and I do not intend to leave His Majesty's correspondence with some peasant.
Matthias saw his mother stiffen next to him. She raised her chin.
¿Está de España?
She said in a language he'd never heard before. The messenger's cheeks flushed slightly.
I do not speak Spanish, madam.
You're not from the king's court in Madrid.
I took over for His Majesty's courier in France.
Donc, je suis Anna Jakobs. Donnez-moi les lettres, s'il vous plaît.
Both the messenger and Matthias stared at her wide-eyed. The only people he'd heard speak anything but Dutch were the priests, who chanted in Latin, and the traders at the market. Yet here was his mother conversing in foreign tongues like a queen. The messenger handed Anna the letter, bowed his head, and then strode back to his carriage. Matthias turned to his mother slowly, half expecting to find that she'd turned into someone else completely. But there she was, the same large brown eyes and rosy cheeks.
What's going on?
He asked.
Not here,
she whispered, glancing down the road before guiding Matthias inside and closing the door. She held up the letter and examined the elaborate wax seal. Instead of the royal coat of arms he'd seen emblazoned on proclamations and flags, there was a large C. His mother had taught him to read and write, but he couldn't think what the initial could stand for. Anna carefully broke the seal and unfolded the letter, pressing her lips together as her eyes traveled across the paper. Her face was tight, as if the muscles were straining to keep some private thought from spilling onto her face.
Mother, why is the king sending you letters?
Matthias asked.
And how do you speak all those languages?
A prickle of dread formed in his stomach.
Are we in trouble?
He asked as terrifying images began to spill out from the dark places in his memory. Over the past year, news of unrest in other parts of the land had reached their village. Protestant dissenters were speaking out against the Catholic Church and Spanish rule. There were rumors that the king's army had begun arresting people during rallies or taking them away in the middle of the night. Yet his family was Catholic, and he'd never heard either of his parents speak ill of the crown. Anna closed her eyes for a moment and then took a breath.
There's something I have to tell you.
The back door slammed, and Matthias jumped. His father, Joost, stormed into the room, leaving a trail of dirty boot prints in his wake.
What's going on? He boomed. I saw a carriage leaving.
It was a message from the king.
Anna held up the letter.
He thinks it's in danger. What's in danger?
Matthias asked. His heart sped up, sending a mixture of fear and frustration coursing through his body.
Watch your tone, his father snapped.
It's fine, Joost,
Anna said, clasping his arm.
It's time to tell him.
She took a step forward toward her son.
There's a special reason we sent you to be an altar boy, Matthias.
She shot a quick glance toward the window.
It's about the altarpiece.
Matthias had been waiting for his mother to say something that would shine a light on the fog that had settled over him since the messenger arrived. But her words only served to thicken the haze of confusion. St. Bavo Cathedral was home to a magnificent altarpiece, a series of 24 paintings by the renowned Jan van Eyck. The work was heralded as a masterpiece, one of the world's great treasures. Artists traveled great distances to study van Eyck's technique. What could the altarpiece possibly have to do with Matthias's mother?
My grandmother came from England specifically to protect the altarpiece. And ever since then, one of her descendants has watched over it. Protect it from whom?
Matthias asked.
There's a dangerous group called the Vespers that's been trying to steal the altarpiece for decades. And it's up to our family, the Cahills, to keep it safe.
It was as if she were still speaking one of those foreign languages, for all the sense her words made to Matthias.
Why us? Wouldn't the church protect it?
Anna shook her head.
They know nothing about the threat. The Vespers are masters at operating from the shadows.
She held up the letter.
The King's Cahill advisors believe that the Vespers are behind the current rebellion and are going to use it to seize the paintings. That's why we need someone in the cathedral at all times.
She gave him a small smile and ruffled his hair.
Like an altar boy.
Matthias took a step back.
But what am I supposed to do to protect it?
He'd never won so much as a wrestling match. How was he supposed to fend off a mysterious enemy? Joost sighed and placed his hand on Anna's shoulder, turning her away slightly.
I told you he was the wrong choice, he murmured. Send Lucas. He's still young enough to be an altar boy.
His words burned Matthias's ears and then spread to his chest like a growing flame. He knew his father was disappointed with him, but hearing proof was worse than he could have imagined, like waking up after a terrifying dream, only to find the creature from your nightmare standing next to your bed.
He's the one,
his mother said firmly, returning to face Matthias.
The Vespers aren't an invading army you can crush with superior strength. That's what makes them so dangerous.
Lucas stands a better chance.
It's my family's responsibility, Joost, and we've chosen Matthias.
Joost stared at her for a moment.
I hope you know what you're doing,
he said, placing his cap on his head.
I must be off.
He nodded at Matthias.
Do your best, boy. We're all counting on you.
Anna watched him leave and then walked over to fetch Matthias's cloak from the peg by the back door.
Don't listen to him,
she said as she draped the rough wool over his shoulders.
I know you'll make me proud, Matthias.
She gave him a final kiss, opened the door, and ushered him out into the fading light.
Come on,
Matthias half shouted, half groaned as he thumped his legs against Mungo's sides. But the mule ignored his rider's exasperated kicks and continued munching on the patch of clover he'd spotted off the road. It was the fourth snack break the beast had initiated in less than a mile. It wouldn't even matter how Matthias was supposed to guard the altarpiece if he never even made it back to Ghent. The wind had picked up, and the skin on his neck and face began to sting. He reached down and stroked the coarse hair on the mule's neck.
Please, if you get me back before dark, I'll give you a carrot.
Mungo twitched his long ears but kept chewing.
And a big, juicy apple.
The mule raised his head and snorted, spraying wet flecks of clover onto the toe of Matthias's left boot. Matthias sat perfectly still as the animal's muscles twitched experimentally. It was crucial that Mungo feel it was his decision to continue. With a resigned whinny, the mule lumbered back onto the path. Matthias sighed as he loosened the reins. Mungo was going to choose his own pace anyway. As they turned down the road through the village, the mule broke into a surprisingly animated trot. His belly jiggled with each step, making it difficult for Matthias to keep his balance. They rounded the bend, and Matthias's stomach flipped. A group of boys about his age was standing in a circle, hooting and hollering as they watched a wrestling match. Matthias slouched deeper in the saddle and tugged the hood of his cloak around his face. But it was no use. They'd seen him. Normally, the Protestant and Catholic children in the village got along, or at least left each other alone. But over the past few months, fights had been breaking out. Most of his neighbors knew Matthias was an altar boy, which made him a target.
Look, it's the choir boy,
a gangly lad shouted to his friends. Matthias's neighbor, Peter, took a step forward.
There's your harp, angel.
Matthias gave Mungo a firm squeeze with his calves, but the mule chose that moment to go investigate some apples rotting in the gutter. Matthias yanked on the reins with all his might, yet he couldn't stop the mule from rushing headlong toward the fruit. He skidded to a stop on the slippery road, and Matthias tumbled off into a puddle of mud and decaying apples. The boys roared with laughter.
Still think you're something special, altar boy?
The tall boy called. Matthias ignored them as he tried to remount, but his boots were covered with mud and his foot kept sliding out of the stirrup. After a few failed attempts, he grabbed the grimy reins and hauled Mungo away from the apples. He climbed onto a wooden crate and then swung his leg over the saddle. Matthias dug his heels into the mule's bloated sides and urged him to walk forward. The boys' laughter echoed through the village square, but Matthias could barely hear them. All he could focus on was the man standing in front of the tavern, staring at him with a look of bitter disappointment. Matthias tucked his chin into his tunic and stared at the ground as he rode by. He'd pretend he hadn't seen his father. And his father could pretend he only had two sons. Matthias couldn't sleep. It was hard to trade the sleepy warmth of his snug house for the chill of the drafty dormitory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.